No one is confused. Nobody. No one is stupid. No one is stupid. Okay. It is only that we all have a very severe continuity problem. Perception is the tool of spiritual arrogance, of spiritual pride. Perception is the tool that makes it seem that it's possible for there to be more or and less of everything, of everywhereness. How can we have more than everywhereness? How can we have less than everywhereness? But perception is a tool that we have made. We're spirit. We're not the prime creator. We are the prime creator. We're spirit. We wanted to see, can we be greater than God? So we needed a tool that seemed to show us greater than and lesser than. God is just one. There's no greater or lesser in reality. So perception is the tool that we have made that gives us the impression of more and less. It's the tool of spiritual arrogance. So we're so seemingly adjusted to perception that we're afraid to give it up. Plain and simple. Plain and simple. Okay, that's the long and the short of it. In a nutshell, we're afraid to give perception up. Period. That's the only problem we have. And of course, everybody plays dumb out of continuity fear. Everybody plays dumb, yes. Some play more dumb than others. But nobody is dumb. No one is stupid at all. Everything is a pretense here. You say, no, don't take my perception away. You know, I'm afraid I'm going to lose my perception, which is simply a device that we have made to give us the impression, a distortion. It's a distortion device that seems to show us valuing and judgment and more and less. I mean, valuing means more and less. Oh, I value this more and I value this less. If we valued everything exactly the same, it would be the vision of oneness. And then we wouldn't be afraid to set perception down. So the way to set perception down is not to just drop it. It's a soft landing, slowly. But first we accept the final perception. We accept a healed perception. We accept healed perception, which is the vision of oneness. I do not have a confusion problem, I have a continuity problem. The vision of oneness solves the continuity problem for me. So that's where our efforts have to be. That's where our efforts have to be. And sometimes we can be quiet. The thing is, everyone has such a severe continuity problem that a lot of people don't even want to work on it. They don't even want to acknowledge it. But they will get a little reassurance. They're willing to feel a little reassurance. If someone who's had healed perception, they're willing to kind of take a peek. That's about it. Take a peek. But some are able to admit that, you know, hey, I do have the severe continuity problem. That's the only problem I have. I have a perception problem. But how do I set down perception? Perception is distortion. It's illusion. It's mirage. What we're seeing is not really there. What perception is showing us isn't there. What do we mean? We say the tree is not there. This is not there. No, what we're seeing is the more and less distortion, that perception, isn't there, actually. It's all a seamless, equal oneness. Spaciousness is the same everywhere. It is a perfect sameness. It is like a perfect backdrop without any qualities and without any inequalities. But perception does not show us that seamless backdrop. It does not show us that. So when we're seeing something other than that, we're seeing what's not there. It's not there. It is not there. It is a distortion. Distortion is showing us something that's not there. Like when we look in like those mirrors that are all wavy and stuff, we look and that's not there, right? It's distorting what is there. So we, as long as we're perceiving the way we're perceiving an extreme distortion and we're hallucinating. We're seeing something that's not there. So the goal is to heal perception, which is what we're focusing on here. And again, some people can't work on it directly. They're too, the continuity fear is too severe for them. So they can only get the sense of, well, it seems like someone is feeling very happy and calm and stable and peaceful. And they can just say, wow, okay, it's possible. And that's as far as they can go. It takes them a while, But eventually that will grow into a willingness to admit they have a continuity problem. Most people cannot admit they have a continuity problem. So they cannot accept the remedy. Obviously, nobody will accept a remedy for a problem they insist they don't have. So that's why very few are able to work on the situation directly. Very few. In order to do that, we have to admit we have a problem. We have a continuity problem. And then working on it directly like this, we accept it because we see, I have a problem, so I'm working on the remedy for the problem. It fits. Okay, it fits. I say, yeah, of course, I'm working on this because I have this problem. But if we completely deny we have a continuity problem, then we won't. We'll say, what does this work for? It's for nothing. What are you doing this for? I don't see any correlation whatsoever. It's crazy. That's how people will feel. So not everybody is going to work on this directly. But everyone can take maybe a little peek, a little look, if someone has had healed perception. They might just take a quick glance and that's it. That's all. But that quick glance is just enough. Quick glance is just enough for the for the Holy Spirit to say, okay, now we got something to work on. You see, it is possible. And they may not want to hear any talk about it at all. So sometimes just silent sitting is helpful for some. Just silent sitting. They don't want to work on it yet. Not ready. Too frightening. They think, if I start working on it, maybe I'll just drop it altogether. Because they do, you know, hate perception so much. But it doesn't go like that. You don't just drop it all together. Continuity fear is too extreme. And the Holy Spirit, that's not the goal of the Holy Spirit anyway. The goal of the Holy Spirit is healed perception, not dropping perception. So the Holy Spirit won't let, when you accept the Holy Spirit for help, it won't let you drop perception. It's aiming at healed perception. So the cat is here today on the bench, producer, and I had a talk with him last night and said, hey, okay, maybe there's some things it wanted me to do. The cat's very interesting. If you're aware, you can notice some things about some animals that they're helping you out. They're catching your attention. This cat is this way. I've noticed that. If something needs to be done, it will somehow draw my attention to it. Or if I'm doing something that's not right, it will draw my attention to that. So what I did was I took off those various playlists off the front website today. I get the feeling like, let's just drop those for now. Maybe the cat's saying, hey, you know, that's a little bit off track. It's a little bit off track. So I decided, okay, let's push those back to the back burner. Not really important. Not important. And get back just to the straight talk here. It's just straight talk. And people were not interested in them anyway. No response. So fine. I say, okay, great. Let's push those off to the back burner and turn the flame off and get straight emphasis here on this healed perception. And maybe that'll help the cat get well. Maybe it's, you know, showing me, hey, habits, you know, there's a severe, you don't want to get off track. Yeah. Because that can really cause you to get way off track. That is true. It's like a homeopathic remedy. You take a little tincture of something, and it helps you build up antibodies, resistance to something like that. But if you take too much, it can make you sick. That is true. So maybe people are not okay with that. So I say, okay, fine, not a problem. Just get back to the straight talk here of healed perception. So I told the cat, I get it. Look, you can get well. It won't surprise me. I've had instances before, people being cured of cancer when I made some adjustment or something, where the grace of God absolutely can cure cancer like that. My dad, again, one day, he came to visit here, and I had a very high spiritual thing going at that time. He couldn't talk, he couldn't swallow, he couldn't drink, he couldn't eat. Severe throat cancer, and couldn't hardly walk. He was dying. He was almost dead. That's why he came home to die. And I said, "Here, drink this glass of water." Which I had this water that was being charged with grace. I've been doing this for quite some time, hoping it'll help him out. And I had tremendous faith that this water was going to help him. He said, "I can't drink." I said, "We just try." And so he tried as best he could. He was able to drink the glass of water. The very next day, he ate a meal. And 2 days later, he ate a big meal. And from that point on, he was just eating massive quantities of food. The entire cancer shrunk in his throat. It shrunk in a matter of 2 days after drinking that water. And his energy returned, and he had bounce, and he was feeling good. But I had not yet worked out this continuity problem situation, and so I was not able to convey that properly. And so the spiritual ambition was still there. Again, our only problem was spiritual ambition leading to this continuity problem we have, because it led to perception. See, spiritual ambition led to perception. Perception leads to a continuity problem. Okay, I didn't have that worked out yet. So he said, "Well, I feel good enough now, I'm going to pursue total cure. I'm going to get rid of this entirely." And so then he went off traveling again, and it came back. Gradually came back. And then that was it. So I know it's possible for cancer to go into remission instantly, very quickly, even instantly, but within a day or two. Personally experienced it. My dad, it just shrunk so fast, it was just amazing. Just through faith in God, the Holy Spirit, and the great teachers, the gurus, the grace of the gurus, the grace of the teachers, knowing, hey, there is an answer for our situation. So I told the cat, "Look, it's okay if your cancer shrinks. Why not? If it grows, it can shrink, right? There's no problem with that." So go ahead and get well. This is not going to shock me at all. Get well. And then I have to just maybe do a few things that maybe that I'm not doing correctly to help it out. So he's still very happy, very happy. And then I said, introduce the idea of the double-double, the cat-cat, the cancer. This has a way of, this is the cure. This is how we get healed perception. Now, Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj was reading that yesterday, and he's talking about how the people of the world are fooled because, let's say, he said, let's take this gold, and then we make ornaments of all this gold. What we're doing with perception is saying that the ornaments, the shape and form of the ornaments, determine the quality of the gold. And some gold is higher quality than others because some forms are more pleasing than others, right? Our perception is showing us more pleasing forms than other forms. Oh, I like this, the different quality of gold. Whereas he says, the only difference between him and us is he sees the gold as primary, We see the form of the gold as primary. That's the only difference. So a shift in perception would be only that we see spaciousness as primary. Okay. And ornamentations of spaciousness as a spiritual ambition is secondary, actually. So nothing has to change except a subtle shift within us of what do we see as primary. I've made this shift a couple times, and this is very simple, amazingly simple, easy. But what happened was I found what I was seeing is so wonderful. I said, wow, people will think I'm, how do I explain to people, you know, why I feel so wonderful, why everything's so wonderful? And then you kind of back off of it. The continuity problem comes back to bite you. So there has to be this patience and calm around this whole issue. And understanding that some people they don't want an explanation, they just want a glimpse, and that's all they can take for this life. That's it. So what I do is I explain clearly, try to explain, you know, healed perception. Just look at it. Let's keep looking at it. Let's keep looking at healed perception, this table, this doubling down. I've been shown in dreams several times. This is the technique. This is the remedy. I'm not seeing, what do I have here? A bag. I'm not seeing like a bag here. I'm seeing a bag. This is a bag. And when we practice that, then the vision of oneness comes. It will feel normal to us. It will feel normal. So we have to have some way of rehearsing, practicing for the vision of oneness so it seems comfortable with it. And we can explain to others. So they feel that there's something they can do. You see, when you feel there's something you can do, there's also something you can undo. So if you don't give people an explanation, they're going to get frightened because they're going to say, well, wait a minute, what if this is too much? How do I undo it? See, people are not interested in how they do it. They're way more interested in how do they undo it. So if you say, well, there's a technique, then they say, great, then I cannot practice this technique if it's too much for me. You can't just say you leap into it and that's it. There's no way people are not going to go for that. So, you know, you get a cancer, how do you undo the cancer? You can undo it too. You just say, cancer. I don't have cancer. I have cancer. Just a subtle shift. It changes the whole landscape, as it were. And yet, it's conceptual, it's verbal, it's perceptual, right? So you can also undo it. You can also go back and say, no, I have cancer. And then you can say, well, maybe I don't have cancer. Maybe I have cancer. Maybe there's cancer here. It changes it, you see. So it's like a teeter-totter. You can kind of play with that. It's very different. You say, well, what do you mean? Cancer, that's different than cancer, isn't it? A cancer is different than cancer. It definitely is. Most definitely is. And so again, people are not concerned about how do we get enlightened, how do we get the vision, they're concerned about, well, what's the technique so they can not do it? How do we not do this? They're way more interested in that. Just in case, because they're afraid of being catapulted into a vision of oneness, and they think the perception is going to disappear, and then, well, how do I get back to this dualistic perception? How do I get back to dualism? Okay. Well, that's why I've introduced zero times zero, or space, or cancer. we can play with this. There's something to play with. It's silly play. We can play with it. Oh, yeah. Is this a tree or is this a tree? I can choose one or the other. Space or space? Is this quantity times zero or is it zero times zero? So, well, I can see it as zero times zero. I can see it as space. I can see it as a plant. Or I can decide not to. And then I'll have dualistic perception. So we want to feel like we can get back to dualistic perception from the vision of oneness. Most definitely. So we want to feel like there's a bridge, okay, that we can cross one way or we can go back across the bridge. We don't want to feel it's a leap. If someone says, you got to take this, you know, leap into it. Well, we say, well, wait a minute. Maybe if I make this big leap, how do I get out of it? So we're not making a leap. Actually, you don't leap into it. We just want to be sure there's a way to leap out of it. So I'm introducing this zero times zero. Or not is a way to, quote unquote, leap out of it. Because actually, everything is already in it. It's already in oneness. So we realize that by letting go of the feeling of leaping. We let go of the feeling of leaping, we realize we're already here. See, we're already here, but the continuity fear wants us to feel this feeling of, you know, I can leap out of where I am. So we feel kind of tense. When we're getting close to vision of oneness, we often become more tense, more anxious. And in our life, we feel anxiety, like, wow, I'm so close to something immense, but how do I get out of that immensity if it's too much for me? It's like that. So we can conceptualize it to a certain way by saying, oh, this is 0, 0. Sure, I know, I understand. This is 0, 0, 0 times 0. If I want, I can do 20 times 0. That's fine. Or this is space. If I want, I can go switch back to form space. Or we say, this is tree-ness instead of just tree-ness. If I want, I can go back to just tree-ness, which then, you know. So you have three options now, where we can easily go back to what we were doing before. So if we see what we've been doing before, we say, this is a tree. We're perceiving it in contradistinction to everything else, and it's dualistic. But if we say, no, this is a tree, we're seeing this tree in relationship to itself. There's oneness, right? The tree is oneness. There's no duality in a tree. There's duality when you see a tree and you see the sky and you see this and see everything else. But when you're saying, I'm seeing is the tree or the sky, then there's no dualism. That's 0 times 0. It's not 0 times something else. We see a tree. It's not a tree times the sky times this times that. That's perception. And again, perception is a tool we have made to serve spiritual ambition. Nothing more than that. God did not make perception. God did not make bodies. Body is just a perception device, an instrument of perception is all. God did not make bodies. God did not make perception. So we did. So we say, I'm seeing a tree, but we can always go back and say, no, I'm just seeing just a tree. Fine. Now we're back in duality. Or what we're saying is I'm seeing space. In other words, tree-ness. And you say, no, I'm a little scared of that, so I'm going back to form space. Now I'm just seeing a tree, and then there's space around it. See, there's a tree. Set off by space, setting off a wall, setting off a shrubs, etc. So there's a bridge there. It's an easy bridge, a footbridge, where you can walk back and forth on it. So if we make it easier to leave, conceptually leave oneness, so to speak, then we'll probably relax into it and say, okay, if it's too much for me, I can easily leave it. So if we understand the mechanism of perception, then we get less frightened. Less frightened to see that everything simply is, already is. Because we can make it seem like it's not. It's dualistic. It's a paradox. The more freedom we feel to be deceived, consciously deceived, consciously to see, make a conscious choice. The more relaxed we feel to not make that choice, because we say, oh, it's there if I need it. God's not trying to take it away from us. You see, it's very important, because we think that God is somehow threatened by what we're doing and is trying to take perception away from us and hide it from us. Not true. The Holy Spirit is not trying to hide perception. So this whole mechanism of choosing either oneness or duality, if we bring it to light and just be able to look at it clearly and say, oh, that's fine, this is a conscious thing, don't hide from it, and say, okay, we actually need to be able to consciously shift back to duality. So it's easy. We realize God's not trying to block that. So we can see just a tree. We can say, see form space. We can see quantity times zero if we want. Sure. We can see cancer if we want, or we can see cancer. Which is then seeing just a pure spaciousness, realizing everything's pure spaciousness. And nothing needs to be seen as better or worse. Now we can ask, well, how does that bring healing? Well, we don't need to dig too deeply into that. Yet, because people are more concerned of how do they get sickness back, actually. That's a fact. Because they'll say, well, how do I get the cancer back? You know, hey, where'd it go? It's gone. Cancer is an expression of spiritual ambition. All sickness is. So when we're seeing the vision of oneness, we don't feel any spiritual ambition anymore. So we might say, well, how do I get that spiritual ambition back? Well, this, you know, maybe I'm too scared. Well, then just see it as cancer, and once again, your spiritual ambition is returns to you. We regain our sense of spiritual ambition through re-identifying with dualistic perception. So if we're scared, like, oh my gosh, all sickness is completely vanished. How do I get it back? Oh, okay, just say, okay, sickness, not sickness, but sickness. Form space. Oh, this is a tree, and then there's space, and there's everything else, and we get our perception back like that. So, this is the wise way to look at it. Is let's make sure we can get the sickness back easily. That's what we're really concerned about. You know, it's like, well, the cancer's gone. Then we start thinking, holy cow. If that's true, I might be able to lose all sickness very quickly, vanish. But where'd it go? It's really, wait a minute, where did my spiritual ambition go? And if I'm without all spiritual ambition, I won't have any perception. If I don't have perception, how do I function? You see, these fears. If we understand the Holy Spirit's mission is to bring about healed perception, is to bring about the vision of oneness, then we begin to relax more and more. God's purpose is not to take perception away from us. It's to have us experience healed perception first, because God knows we have a continuity fear. So God is love, God is wisdom, God is truth. God says, Holy Spirit, your mission is to bring about the vision of oneness. Bring us to the vision of oneness. From there, it's actually God who takes the final step. And God's in no hurry. Eternity's not in any hurry. So when we're fully accepting of the vision of oneness, and we're totally used to it, then we'll realize, ah, I don't even need the vision of oneness. But that's down the road. We're not concerned about that at all here. We're concerned about how, making sure we know or realize we can easily get duality back. So then we need to realize, what is duality, so we can get it back? Because when we shift in the vision of oneness, for sure, at first we're going to say, wow, this is just like so wonderful. I don't know. I'm not sure I can tolerate it. I don't know how others will react and everything. So we'll say, panic, wait, how do I get rid of this? How do I get rid of this? So if we're clear about how easy it is to shift back to duality, then we won't panic. We'll say, well, I can shift back a little while. Let me abide with this vision of oneness for a while. And then I know at some point I can just insist on this. I'm seeing just a tree. I'm seeing tree space. I'm seeing, you know, wall space. You know, instead of just space, space. I'm seeing just a tree instead of tree, tree. And that will then easily pull us out of the oneness, which is just zero times zero, space, space, tree, treeness, thing, thingness, this, thisness, that, thatness. So I'm very confident this teaching is right on track, very confident. Again, it's really about how do we get out of it? How do we get back to duality? Not how do we get out of it. Everyone who comes to teach you, they're really saying, could you have some way to assure me that I can get back to duality? And the teachers say, come on, just jump, just jump, just jump into oneness. Come on, it's fine, just jump. That's not the way. It's better to say, how do we jump out of oneness? Let's focus on that. How do we jump out of it? Make sure there's a way to jump out of it. Be aware of what we're of perception, what perception does. So we're aware of that. So I'm just conveying this to everyone, and that should take the edge off of sickness, take the edge off of cancer. If you realize you can get back to cancer if you want to, then you say, well, maybe I don't need it now. Cancer is just an expression of my spiritual ambition, and it's a way of honoring my spiritual ambition and a way of holding on to it, actually. Sickness is a way of holding on to it, because certainly that brings a duality between wellness and sickness, right? But if we say, you know, okay, I hear what you're saying, and probably it's pretty easy to get back to duality. What a relief. Okay, I don't really need to be sick. Not now. I'm not saying be well forever. Just saying, not now, cancer. I'm going to see you as cancer, which means it doesn't have to be cancer now. I'm accepting cancer, which isn't really cancer. Because there's no reason for duality between wellness and sickness. So we've shifted into a non-dual position where there doesn't need to be contrast. And the inherent quality of the oneness is flawless perfection. There's no problem of functionality whatsoever. So cancer brings about a problem of functionality. If we say cancer, we're shifting to say, well, there's no problem with functionality. So if you reassure people that they can get sick, they're much more likely to drop the sickness and say, well, I don't need it now. I feel reassured. That's what Ananda Maima did. She got sick all the time. It was reassuring. I said, it's no problem. Sickness, I can get sick too, if you want it. And then when people were sufficiently reassured, then the sickness would vanish, sometimes instantly. Boom, gone. She says, why are you so upset with sickness? Understanding that that's what people really wanted, to be reassured. They wanted to make sure that it was still possible to get sick. Continuity fear is the root of the root of the situation. The more we're able to see this consciously, the easier the whole path becomes. And it's just like you step into, you know, the category, a different category, where you seem to be incredibly wise, but it's only because you consciously now recognizing and accepting you have a continuity problem. That's the only issue. As soon as you do that, you shift into wisdom. As soon as you do that, you shift into wisdom. Now, the animals sometimes are sent here to help us. And so they take on our complexes and then reflect those back to us. So if the animal's sick, you look to yourself and say, hey, make an adjustment. And that can help the animal get well. The animal will say, okay, I don't need to be sick. I don't need to reflect this to you anymore. See? Try to see everything in your life as a reflection to help you. As grace. Everything as grace is a reflection. What is it that I need to focus on here? Fluid surrounding his lungs and the cancerous area. Well, I was working with this fluid, the liquid light detergent videos. Maybe it's saying, hey, you know, don't do that right now. Don't do it right now. I said, okay. I did all day yesterday. I did that, and I said, you know what? This is not it. Let's get back to this clear talk here. Let's get back to it. So I put it away. I said, no, forget it. Forget it. For now, I can go back to it later. I'm not saying I'll never do it. Just for now. No. So maybe the fluid will now. No need for it to show all this fluid, problem with fluid, you see. And by looking at this situation with the cat, I've been able to now recognize that what people really want is to be reassured that they can get back to sickness. See, that's something I hadn't recognized before. And this is real true humility is the teachers think, oh, I show up in the world, everybody says, how wonderful, I want to be like them. It's not so. There's spiritual ego in the world. There really is. And they think, come on, you should be enlightened, just jump. No, that's not it. You don't show up in the world and everyone says, oh, yeah, okay, I'm going to be enlightened. No, they're actually very frightened and they say, hey, I want to be sure that I cannot be enlightened. And if you have spiritual ego, you will conflict with that. There'll be some conflict. Say, what are you talking about? Come on. I'm here to help you. You know, I'm a great teacher, I'm a great master, I'm a great guru. That's not it. Then the guru ends up with problem really. People don't react that way. They react like, if you really want to help me, show me how I can be sick. Show me how I cannot be enlightened. Fine, that's what we're doing here. We're looking at that. So spiritual ambition, like Longchenpa, I was reading Longchenpa yesterday, and he says, give up your spiritual ambition. That's the most important thing. Give that up. Give it up. And realizing that what people really want you for is to teach them how to be sick. It's like, wow, I thought I would inspire everybody. But when you're really aware and wise, you can help people realize how they can be sick consciously. And then by doing that, then they're less afraid of dropping the sickness. You see, that's really the way to go about it in this world. Help them see where sickness is coming from. It's perception. It's spiritual ambition. And you don't have to drop that. Help them see the Holy Spirit is not trying to get us to drop perception. God does not want us to try to drop perception. See, God is not, there's not some battle between good and evil with God. The good and evil is perception. More and less. Right? Spiritual ambition brings about this good and evil, light and darkness. There's no light and darkness in reality. There's just the one, the oneness. There's just oneness. There's just oneness right now. It's already here. It's already here now. But the way is to help reassure people that they can actually get out of that. See, the spiritual ego wants to teach everybody, come on, come into enlightenment, come in. But the real way is to reassure people they can come out of it if they want to. That's the right way to teach. Yeah, you can come out of it. Absolutely, you can seem to come out of it. And put them in charge of that. Make reassurance, pushing them into enlightenment. That'll never work that way. Which is why you see some of these spiritual teachers and nobody gets enlightened. No one gets enlightened, really. Or very few. You have to let people feel they're in charge of it. That they're in control of their perception. They're in control. So, when they feel that they're really in control, that perception is not something that God gave us. You see, if God gave us, we're not in control of perception. God can take it away from us, right? So the whole notion of God, that God created bodies, is really the most ruinous type of lie. Because, again, if God gave us bodies, that means God gave us perception, which means God can take bodies away, which means God can take perception away, and we're terrified of that. And so we're willing to kill the body to somehow try and, you know, prevent that. Try and say, look, God, we have a separate will from you. You can't take all perception away. But to accept that God did not create bodies. I am not a body. I am free. I am as God created me. Means God did not create perception. We made perception. We made it. Perception, if it's created, how can it be uncreated? God is not an uncreator. So if God made perception, means God created perception. God only creates. It means perception is permanent. Which, you know, would freak us out, because then we think God's trying to change our perception into something. Any change would be permanent too. It doesn't add up, right? It's the most important issue is to accept that God did not make bodies. We made bodies. Bodies are not permanent, because it's only to serve our honor our creativity that we've made bodies and perception. It's not truly creative. Body's not truly a creation, not really truly creative. It's a way of honoring our creation. We want it to be greater than God, so we're honoring this whim. But we can't actually experience that we're greater than God. So this honoring of our creativity is not true creativity. It's imagery. It's imagination. And so since we made perception bodies, we can change it. We can change our perception. Perception can be changed. If God created bodies, the bodies can't be changed. If they could, that means what God created can be changed, which means God can be changed. And that's the spiritual ambition. We want that to be true. So we insist, no, God made bodies. But that creates a terrible problem for us. Terrible fear. Terrible fear. So Jesus really emphasizes, God did not make bodies. I am not a body. I am free. I am still as God created me. Absolutely essential. For me, somehow I knew God did not create bodies. I always knew. I said, no way. God did not create this temporary impermanence, bodies, perception. No way. No way. But again, the continuity fear is so great that you can say, well, okay, if you want to believe that for a while, fine. But it does bring about severe fear to think that God created bodies, because then we believe that somehow God could somehow, either it's permanent, which is a nightmare. We certainly don't want that, because we realize we'd be trapped in this dualistic conflict. We don't want it. So we're caught in this, if God created it, must be permanent, but we want it to be changed. If God changes, it means God can change what God created. It means God can change us. So it creates this terrible conflict. But we could say, well, God can, quote-unquote, heal it. You know, but the healing doesn't really come from God either. It comes from us. So there's definitely a problem in seeing, you know, healing and God creating bodies, etc., There's a huge conflict problem there. For those who can accept that God did not make great perception in our bodies, that's a wisdom state already. Because this massive conflict and fear then doesn't really arise. You're able to easily work on accepting healed perception, realizing I'm actually one who's healing it, because I'm just simply being willing to accept the condition that I'm already in, just oneness. But I'm willing to accept it with reference points, with perceptually, as zero times zero. It's like an illusion that dispels all our illusions. A mirage that dispels all our mirages. It's like a mirage of truth instead of a mirage of distortion, distorting truth. So anyone's able to accept God did not create bodies, we made bodies. Bodies are simply an instrument of our spiritual ambition. If we can accept that, that's called repentance. That immediately puts you in a state of wisdom, immediately. And then if we realize the way to really get back into severe fear, if you want to get back into fear, just insist that God created bodies and perception, then you're back in fear instantly. It's easy. Easy to get back into fear. So that's another thing. We want to be able to get back into sickness. We want to get back into confusion. We want to get back into impermanency, death. We want to get back into fear. All that stuff we want to get back into. Fine. Easy. So let's focus on how easy it is. Just say, oh yeah, God created all of this. God created bodies. God created perception. Instantly back in conflict, fear, and confusion. Just like that. Simple. So when we're aware of how we can get to fear, then we're also aware how do we get out of it. But again, if we get out of it, how do we get back into it? If we're honest and repentant and conscious of this, then the whole complex can be set down. The whole complex. Because it's still here. We can pick it up. We can pick it up in an instant if we want to. So it's not a forced thing. We're not forcing anybody here. In fact, we're just the opposite. We're saying if you want to believe that God created by great. Because that just serves your spiritual ambition. That's how spiritual ambition is served. And it'll bring you back into fear and confusion, which makes it seem like it's possible to separate from God. So it's easy to pick the complex back up. So if it's easy to pick it up, we shouldn't be worried about setting it down. Good stuff. Oh, it's good stuff. Now if the cat recovers, do I take it back to the doctor and say, look doctor, cancer's gone? No, because the doctor would freak out and say, well, I want the cancer to come back because this destabilizes me, you know, wow, scary, scary, scary. So you don't need to push miracles on people's faces. Yes, you know. Right? What we need to do is to see how do we pick our complex back up, our fear, confusion, death, sickness complex back up, dualistic complex, how we pick it back up. Is it light? Yeah, make it light. It's light. Easy to pick up. Easy. Don't make it difficult. The Holy Spirit's not trying to make it difficult for us. That's the problem that the ambitious gurus can make things worse for us. They're so interested, they're so ambitious, they want to enlighten everyone so they can stand up to the world and say, look, I enlightened everybody. I'm the ultimate. Aren't I the ultimate? They're so ambitious for in that way that they actually make things worse for everyone. Because what we should be doing is saying, now I want to make sure everyone realizes how easy it is to pick up the complex again. Focus on that first. So maybe nobody will be enlightened. Like, I don't know anyone that was enlightened with Sri Anandamayi Ma. But down the road. The benefits may show up down the road. You're not even here anymore. Like for me, it's like I got the grace. I felt something. I said, hey, this is superior. This is some kind of superior teaching. She's not even interested in anyone's enlightenment in the way that most gurus are. It's different, very different. There's no spiritual ambition there. That's what I noticed. The first thing I noticed, she has zero spiritual ambition, none. Very different than a lot of the gurus today. The guru is saying, look at me, look at me, look at me. I am here to enlighten you. I'm going to enlighten everybody. She's not like that at all. No ambition. She says, if you don't want me here, I'll just sit in the corner like a rag doll, not even move. No problem. Doesn't make any difference to me whatsoever. And so that, like shocks the world. And then later on, this people pick this up. We pick it up. There's no spiritual ambition. We don't need to be spiritually ambitious, really. So that actually helped me. You see, how did Sri Anandamayi help me? It helped me avoid a lot of spiritual teachers who are super ambitious. And I said, nah, there's something, they're not quite, there's something there. There's, I'm feeling this ambition, you know, there. So it saved a lot of time, And of course, there's the Holy Spirit is there always saying, also telling you, hey, look, there is a possible way to teach. It's not so hooked into spiritual ambition. Like, look at, here's an example. They say, oh, okay. Well, that's different than these other teachers. And the Holy Spirit says, yeah, it's different. There's a better way. You know, so I'm seeing there's a better way. So really, we should focus on how not to be enlightened. But to focus on us consciously takes repentance. It takes repentance. Because then we have to admit that we have a continuity problem because we've been in this unenlightened condition for a long time out of spiritual ambition. So, but once we admit, yeah, we have a continuity problem, then we can say, hey, okay, now how do I consciously not be enlightened? I want to make sure that I can consciously be unenlightened in case I don't, enlightenment's too overwhelming for me. Just like that. And so maybe the cat was pointing out my own spiritual ambition to me, which is something I'm uncomfortable with. I've always been uncomfortable with it, but the world always holds up these spiritually ambitious gurus and say, oh, you're here to help us? Well, this is how you help us. They don't really help us. I remember Swami Vivekananda, one of the last letters he ever wrote, he wrote this letter to someone. And in that letter, it was sort of a deathbed confession thing. Just before he died, he wrote this letter, and he said, I now realize my entire life has been nothing but a play of spiritual ambition. That's all it's been. And of course, his final ambitious act was to drop his body. That was also spiritual ambition, the way he did that. And then that, the thought forms of Vivekananda, before they dissipated, they were used by another very spiritually ambitious entity to, as a personality form, so that spiritual ambition could be pursued in this world. Okay. And so, but Vivekananda did say, he saw, said, it's all been spiritual ambition, nothing else. So that's a very good, you know, recognition, but it still didn't know what to do about it. So the world holds up these examples of very ambitious, spiritually ambitious beings as if they're masters or great gurus, and says, if you want to help, you need to be like them. And I said, no. But then that put me at odds with the spiritual establishment of the world. Because that way really doesn't work very well at all, if at all. It's saying, here I am to impose enlightenment upon you. No, people will not accept that. Because all they will do is they will pick up and say that, okay, here I am to impose enlightenment upon you too. See, I'm enlightened because I'm imposing enlightenment on you. They're not really enlightened. All they've done is cop an attitude. Just copped an attitude. They're not really enlightened. The enlightened ones, I believe, are more interested in reassuring you of how to pick up this whole unenlightened complex to make sure that you feel it's easy to do and God is not trying to force you to be enlightened at all. Not at all. The Sri Nainamayama is an expression of zero spiritual ambition, reassuring us God's not trying to force us to be enlightened. Not at all. Not at all. But God recognizes we do want to drop this, our spiritual ambition. We want to drop it. So God says, great, fine. Here's the grace to help you with that. But God's not saying you have to drop your spiritual ambition because God's not threatened by it in the slightest bit. If God was trying to force us to drop it, it means God's threatened by it, right? So spiritual ambition is really another way. The spiritual ambitious gurus are really another way of saying that God feels threatened by our spiritual ambition and wants us to stop it. It's not true. It's not true. The enlightened disposition actually can appear in different ways. Can appear as plants, animals, humans, can appear in various ways. And they're so selfless, there's no ambition at all there, that we don't relate to it actually. Not all gurus are human, actually. It's true. I think Ramana Maharshi said that some cow there was enlightened. Various animals. And Anandamayi also said some trees were like more closer to enlightenment than humans. And all different forms are actually that consciousness can awaken. We just don't recognize the awakening. Yeah, she stopped to talk with some trees and people said, why are you communing with the trees? She said, these trees are actually extremely advanced. Very accepting of oneness, way more so than most people, she said. People that thought they'd come to that she had come to see them, and she goes, no, I came to see these trees. Actually, they were calling me to, you know, calling me here. So us humans think that we're, you know, the ultimate. Well. Because we're an expression of spiritual ambition, we seem to be the ultimate expression of spiritual ambition with our perception involving much, you know, much more judgment because we're so mobile. So we're so mobile, we can go so many places and get so much duality and judgment. So we think, wow, you know, we're the ultimate in spiritual ambition. The human form is the ultimate instrument of serving our spiritual ambition. See, we're not bodies, we're spirit, we're formless. So we're not the human body. The human body is just an instrument of our spiritual ambition. It shows us duality very strongly, very strongly. So human embodiment, not embodied, but the human instrument is really showing us how unenlightened we are, how caught up we are in spiritual ambition. So we feel we need this instrument of perception, human perception, to distort, severe distortion, so we can feel it's possible that we can be greater than God, separate our will from God. So when we let go of the spiritual ambition, we don't need a body, human body again. We don't need a human body. We don't need an instrument of perception. We don't need an instrument of perception. What happens is that the human, using the human instrument of perception, duality becomes so intense that we can't stand it anymore. You know, we say, wow, this is too much. I realize I don't want this. So that's why it seems that when spirit uses the instrument of human perception, enlightenment, oh, terrible, the using the human instrument of perception, it shows us just how awful, really, how awful it is, because we're so mobile, and we can get so many things, and you know, it's just like, we realize, wow, this really isn't it at all. This isn't it at all. So the realization, this really isn't it, I don't really want this, comes, and then the spirit says, hey, you know what? I want to drop perception altogether. I've had enough of perception. I've had enough of spiritual ambition. And then the awakening occurs. But it's not humans that are being enlightened. It's spirit. Doesn't mean humanity is great at all. It's just the opposite. Humanity is the ultimate expression of spiritual ambition, to be separate from God. Because it's the instruments that give the such a strong impression of duality, the human perception. So humanity is not getting enlightened. It's not the body, the human body is being enlightened or anything like that whatsoever. It's spirit saying, enough of this. Enough of this. I've had enough of my ambition. How do I set my ambition down? And I realize now I have a continuity fear. How do I deal with this? Vision of oneness. Awareness that I can pick it up again if I need to easily. Say, oh, okay. Thank God. I don't need to. I can have healed perception. Thank God I can have healed perception. I can still maintain the instrument of perception. Human body don't need to die, you see. We don't need to die. We can have healed perception. Because dying doesn't really cure anything. Our ambition remains. We just say, I want even more. When we die, our spiritual ambition remains. We just say, I want a new body that has even stronger distortion. That's what happens. Then we get a new body, young body. Say, oh, great, I'm more mobile. I can go everywhere. You see, the spirit, in its quest for spiritual ambition, in its distortion, wants to distort more and less duality. The more mobile it is, the more places it goes, the more it sees, the more distortion it gets. So it wants a young, healthy body to be able to distort. Where in my situation, I've been fortunate enough to not be well my whole life. So I've not been able to go anywhere, really. I just like sit in my room. So I'm not getting a ton of distortion, you know, being mobile and doing so many things. No. I'm just sitting here. Basically, I've just sort of sat in one place my whole life. That's what the yogis do. They sit in a cave for many 30 years or something. And very helpful, actually, if you use it the right way. It's not just an exercise of spiritual ambition to say, I'm going to sit here. But it's helpful. So when your spiritual ambition has dropped out and you accept the vision of oneness, you don't need an instrument of distortion anymore. You don't need to identify with the body anymore. It's over. It's finished. So again, it's easy to pick up. Just believe that God made bodies, and then boom, you're right back in delusion and fear. It's that simple. A lot of simple ways to regain your unenlightenment, or regain your duality. And so we need to look at all that stuff and just say, yeah, that's great. I'm not trying to take it away from anyone. By all means, be reassured that God has no problem whatsoever. In fact, God is equally lovingly allowing of your duality and your deception, self-deception, your spiritual ambition, as God is of the oneness. Because there's only the oneness. That's happening in the oneness. So anything can happen in the oneness. Spiritual ambition can happen in the oneness. God is just as supportive. The oneness is just as supportive of spiritual ambition, duality, self-deception, as it is of everything else, any other idea. Just as accepting and supportive. 100% pure, perfect. So don't worry, it's not going to vanish. We can pick it up again. Now, ultimately, in order to experience the oneness and the happiness and everything, we do need to set our spiritual ambition down. That is very true. Because if we pick it up, it's fear. If we set it down, it's peace. Peace, love, oneness. So, ultimately, when we want to set it down, then we will. But we don't have to set it down. We can keep it as long as we want to. It's not a problem. You know, there may be a guru in the world, a perfect guru in the world, who's not going anywhere. No one's even seeing them. They're just sitting in a cave. And they're helping out more than anyone. Because they have no ambition, no spiritual ambition whatsoever. And they're not going out to see anyone. Say, I don't need to go see anyone. No one needs to see me. It's fine. If you don't want to see me, that's fine. I don't make any distinction between those who want help and don't want help. Of course, that's God. So if God appears in the world, maybe God will be invisible. I'll be in a cave, no one will know. Or there may be some, you know, that want to pick up on this, you know, drop their spiritual ambition, so they may go see. But maybe God doesn't see anyone, just it's all equal, the same. Those who want to see, those who don't want to see, those who want to be enlightened, those who don't, it's all the same. No difference. And that's very reassuring to everyone. And then people kind of say, okay, God's not mad at us. Not trying to take anything away from us. I can drop this. And then the fear, whew, gone. It's possible for our fear to vanish in an instant, actually. It's possible for our sickness, our turmoil, our mental distress, all of that, to just gone in an instant because we just set the complex down. Why do we set it down? Because we know we can pick it back up. The more we realize we can pick it back up, the easier it is to set it down. I saw that in a dream with me. I was really at death's door, which I am right now. My whole life is almost at a dead end. But in an instant, I set it down, and I chose something else. Peace of mind. And in an instant, it all vanished. Gone. I was suddenly very healthy, robust, peaceful, happy, no problems. Just that quick. Like awakening from a dream. And I can say, well, it will only be that quick when you realize you can pick it up quickly also. Again, see? So I'm seeing more and more how quick and easy it is to pick up deception, duality, spiritual ambition. Just believe God created bodies. Boom, it's right back. So the quicker you realize you can pick it up again, the quicker it is you can drop it. You can set it down. So you can realize, I can set it down in an instant. No problem. So you see, that's how you shrink time. You shrink time by reassuring yourself that you can pick it up in an instant. See, if we think God created bodies, it took all this time to do all this, we think, well, it can take a lot of time to undo it, so to speak. If we realize God had nothing to do with it, that everything's still in the now, perfectly in the now, then we say, well, I can just set it down instantly. Don't need any time whatsoever. I can also pick it up instantly, because we picked all this up instantly. It's always been in the now. Even all our spiritual ambition, our distortion, our perception, it's all been in the now, always. So, it's always been instant. It's always been instant. In an instant, we pick up fear. We can pick up fear. It doesn't take time to generate fear. Fear is instantaneous. So therefore, setting it down can be instantaneous. The cat is listening to all this. Maybe he's got a smile on his face. He's saying, okay, good. You're getting it. This is certainly a new chapter, a new chapter, a new page, a new chapter, a turning of the corner, a way of looking at something I'd not looked at it before this way. It seems blasphemous, doesn't it? Too, in some ways. It's not at all. It's just the result of all the efforts to look at it this way. I said, I can look at it this way. The Holy Spirit suggested, look at it this way. I said, wow, that's like really turning a corner, you know. And so the cat's sickness pushed me into this. And some and other troubles, you know, in my life. Say, okay, I better turn this corner now. I better turn this corner. Paradoxically, more people feel comfortable with this position than the spiritually ambitious guru. And the spiritually ambitious guru will say, well, people are going to see them because they're not really a very high teacher at all, and they're not ready for my real teaching here. You know, they're not ready to be pushed into enlightenment. So that's why they're a lesser teacher or something. That's how it's looked upon. It's looked upon that way. It's fine. It's fine. I was reading on my mom. I would say, I'm not a teacher at all. I'm nothing. I'm just a little girl. I don't know anything. Don't see me as a teacher. Not a teacher. She says she didn't want to see. Otherwise, there'd be this ambition, this conflict with spiritually ambitious teacher, spiritual teachers. He said, I'm not even a teacher at all. You're the teacher. I'm just here. I'm not here for any reason at all. I'm just hanging out. So maybe some people want me here? Fine. If they don't, fine. I won't be here then. Either way is okay with me. She didn't want to threaten the ambition, spiritual ambition. The ego is very clever. It's saying, okay, let's transfer spiritual ambition. Let's switch it over to someone else. You know, let's keep it. It's as always. It's doing the same song and dance as always. We don't even need to look at it that much. Same old, just so it can say, well, we're better teachers, you know, we're better teachers. Spiritual ambition brings about greater gurus, greater masters, greater saviors. So, it just really keeps the spiritual ambition, making it seem it's impossible to set it down. It's what it really does is it makes it seem prohibitively difficult to set it down. And again, all that really happens from the spiritually ambitious teacher is those who come to see them, him or her, a lot more her, the ambition is being transferred over to the her-ness now, is they simply get an attitude. They could pick up that attitude. Oh, I'm a great teacher too. I'm a great master. I'm a great teacher too. I'm here to enlighten you too. Yeah. Then they have this attitude. That's what they get. That's what they get. It's very great. It's very great seeing this. It's like a blind has been, you know, taken away. Blinders have been taken away. There's a lot to process. There's a lot to process, but just verbalizing, it's helpful, very helpful. This is a landmark video for sure. And not got to this position before. Not really. Not coherently. Not clearly coherently. It's crystallizing now. This position is crystallizing. which is great. That's what we need. That's what we need. That's what the world needs, is this position to crystallize. So my point, my perspective is, let's make sure we're aware of what we can do to make sure we're not enlightened. Right? Let's make sure we have that in hand and we have the techniques. Work on that. But see, people aren't working on that. They're so afraid of the continuity problem, even they don't even want to be aware that there are any techniques. They want to make sure that they want to feel that it's immutable, entirely immutable. But then, of course, that nobody really wants that. So the only way out is to be conscious of the techniques and make sure we know how to use them. And I just say, oh, God created bodies and perception. Bingo. We're out of one, the vision of oneness. Gone. And paradoxically, by practicing that, it makes it so much easier and less fearful to set it down. Say, yo, you know, I don't really want to keep suffering with fear. I think I prefer the vision of oneness, so I'm going to gently set these techniques down for now. For now. Set them aside for now. I can pick them up later anytime I want. You know, it's easy. And then set them aside for now, and then we can, vision of oneness. Oh, this is what I really want. That's great. But if I want to take a vacation from it, easy. So we got to be able to know we can take a vacation from enlightenment. Very important. Of course, a spiritually ambitious guru will say, no, your enlightenment failed. You failed. You're a bad devotee. If you really understood what I was saying, you would not lose it. You would not take a vacation. You don't see me. You don't see my greatness. You're not seeing my greatness. You failed as a student. Like that. But paradoxically, the more we practice and realize we can pick it up at any time, vacation, sure, you want to take a vacation, fine. That doesn't have any reflection upon me as a teacher or anything at all whatsoever. In fact, I'd be just as happy if you took a vacation or as not. It's all the same to me. Then you say, well, you know, okay, I'm not going to take a vacation right now. Maybe a little later. Maybe next year I'll take a vacation. I said, sure. If you want to, you know, it's like if there's a teacher, someone's enlightened, and they say, oh, the teacher is an enlightened teacher. Look, I'm enlightened. And then they backslide and they lose it. People go like, oh my gosh, maybe they're not a real teacher. You know, oh, it's terrible. And that student will feel so, I let the teacher down. It's so terrible, so awful. There's all this whole complex is around the, you know, the teacher. But I say, no, if you want to take a vacation, great. Take a vacation. Anytime. Fabulous. No reflection upon me or the Holy Spirit or any teaching whatsoever. It's great. If you want to pick it up, let's make sure you know how to pick it up. Let's make sure you know how to take a vacation here. and then pick it up. That's fine. That's absolutely great. And then just make sure that you it's easy for you. Make sure it's easy. And then you neutralize it. Easy to take a vacation. You take a vacation. You say, you know what? I'm tired of this vacation. I want to set this back down. Great. It's fine. It's all the same. It's all. Everything's still one. Everything's always one. No reflection on the teacher whatsoever. Then people say, well, maybe I'll take a vacation next year. And then the next year rolls around. They say, maybe next year. Maybe next year. Maybe I'll have cancer next year. Take a vacation from cancer. That's all. Maybe next year you'll pick it up. Take a vacation for sickness. They say, oh, the teacher didn't heal. I had a recidivism. No. If they want to take a vacation, take a vacation. If you want cancer back, get cancer back. Fine. Just make sure it's easy. It's easy for you to get it back. And then you see, it's easy to set it down, too. No problem. Interesting. Very interesting. This is very interesting. So the best way to teach, I see, it's being a place that's very worldly. So it reassures people it's easy to pick up, get back to worldliness. It's easy to get back to unenlightenedness. Make it easy for them. And paradoxically, they'll say, great, thanks, that's really wonderful. So since it's so easy to get back to, I'm not worried about setting it down for a little while. Whereas if you take people to some really heavy spiritual place, right? On the Ganges, you're going to be enlightened here. You come here, it's inevitable. It's going to be forced upon you. The intensity is so here, and you won't be able to get rid of it. It'll be with you permanently. Come here, dude, of enlightenment, but they don't get the enlightenment. They don't get the enlightenment. See? Very interesting, indeed. Very, very interesting. Holy cow. This is just a total game changer, a mind blower. It is a mind blower, really. Even dress in worldly ways. The guru who's all guru'd out in this guru'd out place, saying, you're going to come here, I'm going to give you enlightenment. For sure, you're going to get it. Where if we dress up worldly in a worldly place, they say, hey, you come here, it's easy to stay unenlightened here. And it's easy to pick it up if you happen to drop it. If you happen to drop your unenlightenment, if you just happen to set it down, easy to pick it up. We'll help you pick it up. There's no problem whatsoever. Then people will say, oh, okay, that's reassuring. That's fantastic. An entirely different perspective dawns. Oh my gosh. See, so many people are trying to adopt the attitude of enlightenment, the form of enlightenment. So many people are after the form of enlightenment, but not the enlightenment. They want to play the role of an enlightened one, play the role of an enlightened one, but miss the content. They want to have it both ways. That's spiritual ambition. They say, I can do both. I can be both enlightened and unenlightened, both at the same time. You cannot. Cannot do it that way. What we have to do is either we see the vision of oneness or we see duality. One or the other. What we want to be sure is we can easily pick up duality. Should we choose oneness, we say, oh, I can get back to duality easy like that. Gosh, fantastic. You can thank the cat and my family and the circumstances I'm in for all of this, really. His difficult circumstances is pressuring me into looking at this. So I ask the grace of the Holy Spirit, if I've been able to look at this fruitfully, then please grace the sickness of this cat. Let the cat go back into oneness. Doesn't need the sickness. Okay, it served its purpose. The sickness, the cancer served its purpose. Now, can shrink away. Right? The tough circumstances of my life have served their purpose. Now I can shrink away. All these problems I have can now shrink away. Not a problem. I can accept good circumstances, actually. I don't need to play the role of the guru, Don't need to play the role of the guru. Don't need to play the role of the form of enlightenment. Don't need to. So, it's a turning point today. What is today? The 8th of June. And by the way, this applies to everyone. Human form instrument, alien form instrument. These are all instruments of perception. All the forms are instruments of perception. Instruments of spiritual ambition. God did not make any form whatsoever. Did not make perception. So this applies across the board. Christ applies across the board. Don't worry, you can get back to your spiritual ambition instantly. No problem with it. I have no problem with that whatsoever. Absolutely. In fact, I insist that you be aware you can do that. It's all important. Otherwise, you will feel in competition with God. God is not supportive of the oneness, and you won't be able to recognize the oneness that is obviously present. So this is really a form of prayer for those, all those that are suffering. The cat is suffering, it gets sick. This is a form of prayer to bring this, crystallize this. I think the effort towards clarification is the highest prayer, in my opinion. It's the highest prayer there is. That's the highest compassion, is your own effort towards clarification, is shedding compassion upon all instruments of perception, upon all spiritual ambition, upon all continuity fear. It's shedding light and love upon all continuity fear. See? So, absolutely, your work on clarification, you are working on the highest prayer and the highest compassion for everyone. It's a true bodhisattva activity, actually. Sri Saradatta Maharaj didn't really have much of the form of enlightenment thing going. You know, he was a business person, an entrepreneur, small market handmade cigarette salesman, family man, businessman, and didn't really have the trappings of enlightenment, of guru-ness and all this trappings. Just a, you know, simple person living in a city. So people go to him and say, "Hey, you know, I don't know how do I get the form of enlightenment from you?" And he says, "Forget about the form of enlightenment. You know, forget about it. What do you want that for? Get the gold. But, you know, so." People were afraid of him because they said, I don't know how to get the form of enlightenment. But here, we're emphasizing the continuity fear. It's a little different emphasis here. Different emphasis. But I can see how that would be very appealing. This when you're not really after the form of enlightenment anymore, then someone like Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj can be very helpful and appealing, actually. Because that's not even an issue, you know. There's like boom, 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 boom. It's like, wow. It's like a hammer. You know, just every nail's hammering down the nails like that. Just, wow. It's very obvious, you know, what he's saying. It's like, wow, very helpful. But it's not everyone's cup of tea, so that's fine too. That's fine too. And it's fine if someone wants a form of enlightenment, that's great too. That's just, again, expression of their continuity fear. So let's make it easy for them to have that as a way of protecting themselves from the vision of oneness, is make sure they can jump it back to the form of enlightenment. That's all good too. Just let them be easy experts at that. Do it in 2 minutes. Do it, you know. Throw on the wig. Throw on the clothes, the wig, the makeup, the beads, the incense, whatever. Just do it quickly. Okay, there it is. Okay, now I'm back in the form of enlightenment. I've got my spiritual ambition back. Easy, no problem. But then they say, "Ah, okay, it's so easy. Maybe I can set it down now. I don't really need that." So we need to be conscious of our defenses, make sure we can pick them up easily, and then make it easier to set them down, knowing they're right at hand if I need to pick them up again. It's like that. And it's very helpful. Very helpful, very helpful. All right. Well, very great. feels like, yeah, the corner has been turned. I just need to let stay with this and let it keep rolling. Let the momentum keep going. All right. All right, great. That's it for this video.